Wit, and it be thy will. Put me into good fooling. I'm Kweli Washington, and this is Counterculture.
I often think of the life I've led, and oh, it's a wonder I ain't dead. Drinking and gambling, staying out all night, living in a fool's paradise. My mother told me.
Dateline, June the 29th, 2012, New York City, New York. I'm Kweli Washington, and this is Counterculture. Well, folks, we spun the dial and landed squarely on arts and culture. My guest this evening is Mikel Rouse.
If I'm broken, I'm broken beside you, and when I'm looking for someone to run to, and if you're thinking I'm sinking slowly to heaven, hold you my one hand, if only you could be here hanging around year after year, near to the ground, silence of sound. And if I wonder, I wander around you, a semicircle of heaven and hell, to a karaoke machine that will not quit a song to nowhere. Hit after hit, and if you could be here hanging around watching the waves near to the ground, silence of sound. And if I'm able, I'll manage a phone call to check your ankle and catch your free fall. The kitchen's crowded, the blender's a riot, 'cause here in Clinton we keep things quiet. If you could be here hanging around year after year, near to the ground, silence of sound, silence of sound. My soul's in great adventure jail, my body and soul's in great adventure jail. I'm trapped in here, model mapped in here, hand clapped in great adventure jail. Joey's in great adventure jail, you and Joey's in great adventure jail. Can't get no bailing, can't get no mailing, no love for sailing, great adventure jail. The world's in great adventure jail, the whole world's in great adventure jail. We're all let down in all the same town, in where lost and found, in great adventure jail. We'll be in great adventure jail, we'll all be in great adventure jail. On Judgment Day, and we'll hope and pray and for one more day in great adventure jail.
So my guest this evening is Mikel Rouse, a composer who just performed two beautiful songs for us. Mikel, you want to tell us the titles of the song and a little bit about the context that brought them about?
Yeah, the first song is called Silence of Sound, and it's from a piece called Gravity Radio that we did at the Brooklyn Academy of Music about a year and a half ago, and we're currently touring that now. So I keep that song fresh. And then the second song I did is from my 29th CD called Corner Loading, and that song is called Great Adventure Jail.
And Great Adventure makes me think of an amusement park about 3 hours away from New York City.
And that's exactly what it is. A friend of mine who was a bartender told me a story when he was a kid about doing something wrong at Great Adventure Jail and getting arrested. And he said, at Great Adventure, and he got arrested, and he said, I was in Great Adventure Jail. And I just thought that's the greatest title I ever heard.
It resonated.
Yeah. And I was, the record Corner Loading I was working on, was very influenced by Delta Blues, because I studied with some Delta Blues people when I did a residency in Louisiana a number of years ago. And I was always fascinated with hand clapping songs, Sun House and stuff like that. So I found a way to use the metric structure that I like and at the same time sort of pay homage to that music.
It's a complex structure, isn't it?
It is. I'm clapping in five while I'm singing in a different metric structure, and it looks simple, but it's a little bit more complicated, I think, than it looks. So.
And do you typically perform with a group, and who, if so, kind of what are the pieces that you work with?
Well, it's always been different. I mean, with the modern opera trilogy, there was one piece that was a solo performance piece, but the second opera, Dennis Cleveland, was staged as a television talk show with a cast of about 25 people and a full camera crew. We'd basically do a live TV show taping.
Much like this.
This
is familiar territory.
It's very familiar territory.
Good.
But then with Gravity Radio, the piece that's on tour now, that's basically singers and a string quartet, but then we also have a newsreader that reads, we update the news from the AP every day, and so then that news is orchestrated by string quartet in between the songs, and so the result is that every night it's a different feeling, because it might be a happy story or a tragic story, but the music is staying consistent, and it just kind of provides a nice interlude between the songs. Every piece is different, and then of course with the piece I just did, that's another solo piece.
Sure.
Yeah.
What brought you to this pursuit?
Well, I was very lucky. I mean, I started drawing at a very early age, about the age of four. So I think everybody thought I was going to be a visual artist. And then, I was very lucky to grow up in the 60s. And I lived in a small town called Poplar Bluff, Missouri, which was earshot from Chicago and WLS. And so you were hearing, before there was genre-based or format radio, it was just, in my opinion, really good radio. And there were no... you'd hear Motown, you'd hear the latest stuff coming out of the British invasion. So it was an incredible moment in popular music, and I was hugely influenced by
that.
And
you were tuned into it.
Tuned into it and loved it. So then when I decided to go to school, I ended up studying in Kansas City, Missouri at the conservatory, but across the street from the conservatory of music at the time was the Kansas City Art Institute. So I did a double major studying music at the conservatory and filmmaking and painting at the Art Institute, and then came to New York and mostly focused on music because I kind of wanted to excel at something. But I always wondered, you're still doing visual art, you're still interested in directing. When is that going to kick in? And if it doesn't, that's fine. But then in the late 80s, early 90s, when I started directing these large multimedia operas, all the filmmaking and all the visual stuff sort of
came rushing in,
back, and it's been a pretty satisfying thing to integrate, video, film, and performance with the music.
Are there certain principles that you apply to bringing those different streams of art together?
I'm very interested in structure. I mean, my music sounds very much like popular music, as you can tell, but there's an underlying structural element that I guess could only be really called classical in terms of how I write the songs. And it's, my goal is to make music that's very accessible. I was very fortunate to also grow up, trailing composers like Philip Glass and Steve Reich, who thought, it can be complicated, but it could also be fun to listen to. Didn't have to just be paper music. And but when I started integrating the visual elements into that, I found that I could do things with images that corresponded to the multi-metric structure of the music, so that they were felt, as an audience member, you feel that there's an organic logic to it. You don't have to understand music, or you don't have to understand film editing, but it's that structure that makes it seem like it's actually happening in a logical thing. It's almost like subliminal advertising, except that it's tying the images to the metric structure of the various components of the music. And I found it to be a very beautiful way to, you know, way to incorporate images into the works where it doesn't just feel random, like, oh, he just stuck video up behind the music, and that's what everybody does.
And so the actual alignment of the elements of structure in the visual art and the elements of structure in the music happens in the process of composing the art, the visual art itself, or what? Or
That's pretty much it. Yeah. Uh-huh. Sometimes one will come before the other, but somehow there's a desire to integrate those two things in a way that feels natural within the structure.
Sure. Yeah. So I've spoken to a couple of musicians along the way, composers, singers, and songwriters, and I always want to ask them, kind of, what's the actual process of coming to a piece? If we take Great Adventure Jail as an example. You mentioned a desire to play with these sort of contraposing metric structure. You talked about a desire to kind of reference this particular genre of music. But when it actually comes to sitting down and doing it, is it the melody that comes first? Is it the lyric? You mentioned the inspiration of your friend having gotten stuck in jail there.
It's all those things, because if it was just one of them, I think that would start to feel rote. You'd be repeating yourself. But I carry, sketchbooks around, and I'm always writing down words, phrases that I hear people say, or writing down lyrical phrases. But then sometimes it's just the fun of, being in a recording studio and working on music in layers and seeing how that starts to unfold. I did a lot of studying of structure, and I studied this thing called the Schillinger system when I was much younger, and because it was so interesting the way Schillinger thought about the mathematics of music. But
In a nutshell, if there is a nutshell of the Schillinger system, what is it?
It kind of got a bad rap because people thought of it as a system, sort of as like dodecaphonic music as a system. But it really got a bad rap because Tin Pan Alley composers and even George Gershwin studied under Schillinger and used some of these techniques. And it basically allowed people, it was really helpful to Tin Pan Alley composers because they were having to write a lot of music all the time. If they had to wait every day for inspiration, they'd be out of a job. So he sort of showed ways to do, infinite variety of theme and variations through rhythm and through circular permutations of notes. And it's just a very different way of thinking. It's a more scientific way of thinking about music. But the thing I liked about the Schillinger system is that you could use it if you were writing classical music, you could use it if you were writing pop music. It was not genre specific. But at a very, very quickly, I would say probably by the time in my late 20s, I was so thinking this way that I wouldn't say I abandoned the system, but I just don't write that way anymore. I listen to a song on the radio, and I'm always either clapping or singing in a different meter to the song.
That's how you experience
music.
The music. Take part in it.
And I think that's more normal for other cultures, not so much in America. Or Western European music that's more tied to a duple meter.
Sure. Now, Michael, you are up to your 30th recording.
Yes.
I want to just get a little flash here in the camera, if we could. Boost False Doors?
Yes.
Tell me a little bit about this piece.
Well, I was working on False Doors before we started the Gravity Radio Tour. And I finished that, I think, in 2010. And I thought that was going to be its own record. And then I finished, and then the next year I started working on Boost, which is, almost a polar opposite sounding record. There's a comparison in the guitar work, steel guitar, slide guitar, vocal.
So same instrument or some similar instrumentation.
Some similar instrumentation, but with False Doors, it's all organic, prepared piano, live drums, live bass. It's all very organic sounding record, whereas Boost is very much like a techno record. It's huge electronica kind of sounding.
Wow.
And many people were sort of calling False Doors like my Buddhist record because it was sort of about acceptance, but then Boost ended up being about the ending of a relationship that was very important to me. And I looked at those records, that I thought were so different, and all of a sudden they looked very similar. And so I just thought, it's my 30th release, I'll just put them out together as a double CD.
Let's turn the counter, shall we?
Shall we?
Let's turn to politics. We had a big Supreme Court decision this week. The Supreme Court decided to uphold basically all of the healthcare law, most of the healthcare law, and particularly the individual mandate. Mm-hmm. Be curious to know what your reaction is.
I was following it, I think as most Americans, I was following it pretty closely. Mm-hmm. And I was following all the analysis of the three or four different potential scenarios. And I was up Monday morning listening to NPR, thinking that they might announce it on Monday morning. Mm-hmm. And they didn't. And then they said, well, that means it'll be sometime after 10 a.m. on Thursday. So I was glued to the radio, and it was a very, it was a funny experience. You know, the media had done a pretty good job of getting everybody excited, whether they were or not. Mm-hmm. I think many people were, but, mm-hmm. and, you know, I was listening to WNYC, a guy named Brian Lehrer,
sure.
And the surprise and the shock in his voice sort of said it all. I think that the media had done such a number at setting up the potential scenarios, mm-hmm. that that was maybe the last one anybody thought of.
Sure. There was a certain resignation to something not going right with the outcome.
Yeah.
And were you surprised at who the justices were who were in the majority?
Absolutely. Uh-huh. I mean, I remember when they were presenting the case, and everybody was nervous because they thought Kennedy would be the swing vote, and he was really grilling and basically saying something to the extent that the government has a heavy burden here, mm-hmm. to be able to say why this mandate is not unconstitutional. So I think everybody was counting on, well, which way is Kennedy going to go?
Sure.
And we saw which way Kennedy went. With Roberts being the fifth vote, that was pretty amazing.
And what do you reckon? Is there a shift afoot? Is Roberts asserting himself in a different way on the court? Is he now the fulcrum?
Well, I mean, there's a lot of news analysis going on, mm-hmm. about that right now. And I think that it'll take time to flesh out. A lot of experts say, you know, don't look for him to become, you know, a liberal, mm-hmm. swing vote or something. Mm-hmm. I do think he puts himself in play the way Kennedy has been in play.
Sure.
And I think that's the first time anyone's felt that from Roberts. Mm-hmm. And, you know, there was some analysis I read recently that did give, you know, Roberts some props about, you know, not that this is the role of the Supreme Court, but maybe lowering the tone, mm-hmm. of just constant partisanship.
Sure.
So whatever the outcome, I mean, I do think that conservatives like the idea of the court not, you know, legislating, mm-hmm. and in a sense that's what they did.
Sure. Lowercase c, conservatism, right?
Yeah,
sort of judicial
yeah.
restraint, I think.
And there were many experts who thought Roberts' logic was flawed,
mm-hmm.
you know.
Mm-hmm.
But I think that he was bending over backwards to say, mm-hmm. "I'm not going to overturn this unless it's a clear case." And
sure.
obviously, you know, the dissenting votes clearly thought they were. You know, Kennedy's statement in particular was, this is wrong.
Sure, sure.
Yeah.
I think Roberts did say, right, he wasn't commenting on the wisdom of the electorate.
Yeah, he's going away to Malta or something like that.
Some
funny thing about
Malta
being being unfindable.
Uh-huh.
That was the impression I got from something I heard.
Michael, I'm going to pull us back to two things that you mentioned earlier. Actually, you mentioned Kansas City,
mm-hmm.
and I was curious. Hasn't Kansas City been in the midst of a real renaissance around the arts? This is kind of circling back to the arts. We've done a tremendous amount of kind of growth in cultural institutions and kind of strengthening that core.
It's an amazing place. I went back about a year and a half ago for two reasons. I received the Alumni Award from the Conservatory.
Congratulations.
Thank you very much. Yeah. But my nephew, who's both an artist and musician, ended up going to the same art school that I went to.
Mm-hmm.
And when I left Kansas City, I moved here with a band, and I guess that was about 78.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, it was an incredibly wonderful art scene and music scene going on in New York. So that was, you know, and the internet did not exist yet. I mean,
mm-hmm.
but staying in Kansas City wasn't an option. You know, that was other than the fact that we really wanted to be where this incredible explosion of culture was happening in,
mm-hmm.
New York City.
Mm-hmm.
Staying in Kansas City, if you were going to try to be a working artist, wasn't an option.
There just wasn't the support for it.
Yeah, uh-huh. I mean, there was a conservatory that was fabulous, and there was the Art Institute that was fabulous, but there was nothing, you know, going on in the city.
Mm-hmm.
And I go back now, and it's unbelievable. It's unbelievable the explosion that's going on. There's galleries and galleries from New York who set up shop, and they have on a smaller scale the same complaints that New Yorkers have. That,
uh-huh.
you know, there were these neighborhoods that artists developed, and now
too expensive for them to live in.
Yeah, but you know, there's a First Fridays thing where people go to galleries and,
uh-huh.
and check stuff out. There's an active music scene. So, And you know, there was a, you know, keeping in mind the business topic, about a, maybe anywhere from 9 months to a year ago, there was an article in Crane's Business about these pockets that are happening in America, like Cleveland and mm-hmm. like Philadelphia, that are sponsoring artist housing and artist lofts, you know, mm-hmm. work subsidies.
Sure.
And how New York was really running a risk of becoming like Washington, D.C., where it's a great city to see art, but no artists live there.
Uh-huh.
And I think there was a statistic in that Crane's article that for the first time, maybe like in 40 or 50 years, New York wasn't the first destination for artists and musicians coming out of school.
Very interesting.
I think it's, you know, if you told people, you know, in the 40s in Paris that New York was going to be the art capital, they would have laughed at you.
Sure.
And I think that the administrations in New York, you know, over the last 10 or 15 years have just thought this was a grant. This was a right.
Sure.
People were always want to be there. It's the most exciting city. But I didn't move to New York because it was the most exciting city. I moved to New York because there was an incredible art scene,
yep.
and it was affordable.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and
mm-hmm.
artists go where they can do their work. They don't go because they want to pay the highest rent
sure.
possible.
We've handed the keys to the real estate developers here now.
Yeah.
So
they're not thinking
about artists.
And what was so interesting about the article, you know, if you'd read that in the Times or the Voice or something like that, that would be one thing.
Sure.
But this was an article in Crane's,
yep.
because it was talking about the implication of business, of restaurants,
uh-huh.
of all these different things that will suffer if there isn't something done about this problem for
mm-hmm.
artists, you know, being able to come and being able to focus on their work as opposed to waiting tables.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And then the other thing you mentioned in passing was you made a reference to Missouri.
Mm-hmm.
And I've got to ask you, what's the distinction between Missouri and Missouri for someone who's born in California and has never lived, never actually stepped foot in the Show Me State?
My understanding is that if you grew up in the Boot Heel, which is where I grew up,
mm-hmm.
Which is that little area that goes into Tennessee and Arkansas, you're closer to the South. So we said Missouri because we sort of draw out
mm-hmm.
our vowels.
Mm-hmm.
And if I went, so when I went to Kansas City to go to school up north,
mm-hmm.
and I said Missouri, they go, oh, we know exactly where you're from.
It coded you, sets you in a regional frame.
You're a
uh-huh.
hick,
uh-huh.
basically.
Okay.
So I still say it, and most people hear Missouri, so they don't know why someone would say Missouri.
Great, Michael. Well, let's turn the counter then, but stay in Missouri. Let's turn to food. How about that? Barbecue is one of the big ones in Kansas City, isn't it?
Is it
more the dry rub?
No, they have.
What do they do?
It's a sauce.
Uh-huh.
It's a sauce. I, you know, coming from the South, I was a huge snob about barbecue.
Mm-hmm.
Didn't think that you know, people up north would know how to do that
sure.
very well. But Kansas City has a restaurant called Arthur Bryant Barbecue
uh-huh.
that is, I think, the greatest. I mean, Calvin Trillin, the food writer.
Yes.
He's more than a food writer.
Yeah. A writer.
Wonderful writer. He used uh-huh. to write for The Nation. But he also wrote the Tummy Trilogy, and I think he called Arthur Bryant's the best restaurant in America. Not the best
wow.
barbecue restaurant.
Best restaurant in America.
And it's still a pretty, when I go back, it's still a pretty amazing thing.
And what constitutes a great restaurant? And
well, the
Arthur
thing
Bryant
about,
is an example.
You know, when I first went to Bryant's, I hated it.
Mm.
And I said, these people don't know what they're doing. This is, you know. And I went home, because it was when I was first going to school there.
Mm-hmm.
I went home. And I've always been very lucky. I'm much more interested in things I don't like than
mm-hmm.
things I like.
Mm-hmm.
Because I figure if I like it, I already know how to like it.
Mm-hmm.
So I
this is food only or across the board, everything in life?
Yeah, this is how I figured out, you know, when I did my first opera, I didn't like the way it sounded, and that's why I trusted to keep going in the direction I was going.
Mm.
I invented a whole new way of working with text because of that. If I'd gone by my first reaction, I would have just not continued working.
Tabled
on
it, okay.
So for 2 weeks, I couldn't stop thinking about this place. And then I went back and I tried it again, and then you know the skies opened up and the angels sang, and I understood what it was. And what it was, it was so original. It was a very original take. So you wouldn't call it an Italian restaurant. It's definitely barbecue,
mm-hmm.
but it was something different because it was this guy's original idea.
Hmm.
Like you know, like everyone. If you're a painter, everyone's still dealing with paint, but
mm-hmm.
sometimes somebody
pushes
does something
it.
So completely
sure.
original, and that's what made Bryant so remarkable.
And in the way that he prepared the food,
everything, the
uh-huh.
way the pitmaster
decor.
Works, and
uh-huh.
then of course the decor is unbelievable. Yeah, just the vibe of the place is amazing.
Huh.
And then the sauce is like no barbecue sauce you've ever had in your life. It is truly a remarkable feat.
Got it.
I have friends, you know, who were I'm mostly a vegetarian now, but back in the day, I had friends who were vegetarian. They'd put this sauce on vegetables, on cottage cheese, because everybody recognized this as one of the most original tasting sauces you've ever had.
Do you have a sense of what the base of the sauce is?
I don't. I mean, there's more vinegar, less sugar, that's for sure. Uh-huh. But it's a remarkable thing.
Incredible. I'm really partial to the Carolina kind of pulled pork barbecue.
That's
a kind of vinegary sauce as well.
Yeah.
But maybe talking a little bit about folk foods, are there particular restaurants here in New York or food stands or food trucks that you really dig these days?
I would say, one of my favorite places in all of New York, which was an old hamburger egg cream place called Prime Burger. Had been there for 74 years on 51st Street between Madison and Fifth, just closed.
Oh,
that was a tragedy.
That's a shame. If we had a little alcohol in here, we'd pour some out for it.
That's exactly correct. Hopefully they'll find, they may find a new place. But
okay,
it was
so
really
it was a rent situation or something?
Yeah, rent. Uh-huh. And a beautiful, place. I love a place called Esca. That's my sort of my neighborhood joint.
Where is Esca?
Esca is on 43rd between 9th and 10th. It's a fish restaurant. It's Dave Pasternak's place. And I love the bar there. I love Vic at the bar. It's just a really, really wonderful sort of local family kind of feel, even though it's obviously a very popular restaurant.
Yep.
And the food trucks are an amazing thing in New York.
They've really proliferated here in recent years, haven't they?
There's a lot more in Los Angeles and in San Francisco, but now I have them here. And then I recently read an article in the Times about the food trucks making their ways to Paris.
And what's the story with food trucks in Paris? A kind of distinctly American phenomenon, huh?
Yeah, and they're making everything from hamburgers to tacos, and it seems, from what I could gather from the article, the young people love it and the old people hate it. Because it's the threat to tradition.
Sure.
But there's
destabilizing, but it's cheap. It's cheap, stylish.
And these are also chefs doing this.
Uh-huh.
These are people who are really kind of bringing a certain, I think, an area of sort of gourmet cooking to the food truck.
The ethos of Brooklyn now Fifth Arrondissement.
But the young people love it, because they seem to really be, enamored of things that are American, especially in cuisine.
Sure. Michael, this has been so wonderful. Let me just get the CD up here one more time. It's Boost and False Doors. The artist, the composer, the musician is Mikel Rouse. And Michael, you've been a wonderful guest here on Counterculture. I so much appreciate you being here.
Pleasure to be here. Yeah, nice to meet you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
That brings to a conclusion the 12th episode of Counterculture. My guest this evening has been Mikel Rouse, composer. You can purchase his CD, Boost and False Doors, online.
Online, iTunes, and stores, it's
excellent.
Pretty much everywhere.
Is there a website?
And my website,
And his website. Fantastic. So look out for it. That brings to a conclusion this episode of Counterculture. Cue the music.
I often think of the life I've led, and oh, it's a wonder I ain't dead. Drinking and gambling, staying out all night, living in a fool's paradise. My mother told me, and father told me too, said, my child, it'll all catch up with you. Drinking and gambling, staying out all night, living in a fool's paradise.